Hello friends, good afternoon and welcome dear friends to CEC live lectures. Dear friends, as you know that in inorganic chemistry we have started a series on aldehydes and ketones, and today we are conducting fourth lecture in aldehydes and ketone. To discuss this topic we have with us our subject expert Dr. Aparajita Chauhan. Dr. Chauhan is associate professor in department of chemistry in Sri Aurobindo College, University of Delhi. Without further ado, I would like to welcome ma'am to our studios and request her to start the lecture. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you. Without further ado, we will start with the lecture. In this series, we have already discussed methods of preparation of aldehydes and ketones and also their physical properties. Today, we shall be continuing with the chemical properties of aldehydes and ketones. What we know is that aldehydes and ketones have a carbonyl group as their functional group. Now, this carbonyl group is polar in nature because there is difference in electronegativity of the carbon and oxygen attached to it. Oxygen is attached to carbon by a double bond. Since oxygen is more electronegative, it pulls the electrons towards itself, resulting in a slight positive charge on carbonyl carbon. So this carbonyl carbon becomes electrophilic in nature and tends to undergo nucleophilic reactions. Secondly, what we find here is that carbon and oxygen are connected by a double bond. So the reactions are going to be addition reactions across this double bond, and hence aldehydes and ketones undergo nucleophilic addition reactions. They also undergo nucleophilic addition elimination reactions, which we shall be discussing today. And along with that, they also undergo oxidation and reduction reactions. But today we shall be concentrating on nucleophilic addition reactions. So if I talk of nucleophilic addition reactions, what we see, if we look into the structure of the carbonyl group, then what we find is that the carbonyl group is attached to two groups, which may be an hydrocarbon part and the other is hydrogen. In case of aldehydes, it is always, the carbonyl group is always attached to one hydrogen. Whereas in ketones, it can be attached to two hydrocarbon groups. So these two groups, that is H and alkyl group, are too basic to be eliminated under normal conditions, and carbonyl compounds will undergo addition reactions. So what we find here is that if I say a nucleophile is approaching at this carbon, that is a sigma bond is being formed here, then at the same time we know when a bond is being formed, a bond will be cleaved. But as I have already said, that the bond between carbon and hydrogen and the bond between carbon and the alkyl group or the hydrocarbon group cannot be cleaved because these two groups are strong bases to be eliminated under normal conditions. So what happens under these circumstances is that the double bond breaks, that is the double bond between carbon and the oxygen breaks, and a new sigma bond is formed here. So as a result of this, carbonyl compounds undergo nucleophilic addition reactions. Now, a question will come immediately to your mind that if aldehydes and ketones are undergoing nucleophilic addition reactions, is the order of the reactivity the same? That means that aldehydes and ketones will react at the same rate with the nucleophile. Then let us look into the structure of the molecules. As I've said that in aldehydes, the carbonyl group is attached to a hydrogen. Now this hydrogen is more electronegative as compared to an alkyl group, and it will pull the electrons towards itself, as a result of which the positive charge on this carbonyl carbon will increase. If I compare it with a ketone, then what we find is that in ketone, we have both the groups are alkyl groups. And because of the plus I effect here of the alkyl groups, the positive charge on the carbonyl carbon will be less, and it will be less reactive towards nucleophilic addition reactions. Second point, if we compare the structure or we compare the size of hydrogen with an alkyl group is larger in size. Since this alkyl group is larger in size, it will offer steric hindrance to the incoming nucleophile. In other words, aldehydes are more accessible to nucleophilic attack. Hence, aldehydes are more reactive than ketones towards nucleophilic addition reactions. So among aldehydes, please remember, formaldehyde is most reactive because in formaldehyde, carbonyl group is attached to two hydrogen atoms. Not only this, we have to take another aspect of the reaction. That is, if we look into the structure of the reactant, what we find is that the carbonyl group is sp2 hybridized. That is, the carbon in the carbonyl group is sp2 hybridized. That means carbonyl groups, carbonyl compounds have a planar structure. And when they undergo nucleophilic addition reactions, the bond angle becomes 109. That is, it becomes tetrahedral in structure. So when the bond angle decreases to 109, and supposing we are doing the reaction with a ketone, there is steric interaction between these groups here. And because of this steric interactions, which are more in the product as compared to the reactant, this is unstable and the reaction is low. So in conclusion, what we can say is that if the ketone is highly alkylated, then the four groups in the product are closer than the three groups attached to the carbonyl carbon in the reactant. And these alkyl groups will destabilize the product and stabilize the reactant, as a result of which delta G in case of ketones is more, and ketones are less reactive than aldehydes towards nucleophilic addition reaction. Not only this, if an electron withdrawing group is attached to a carbonyl group, then those aldehydes or ketones are more reactive than the unsubstituted aldehydes and ketones. And the other factor that has to be taken into consideration is that if the aldehyde group is capable of undergoing conjugation with another group which is attached to it, in this case we have a phenyl group, this undergoes conjugation, the pi bond of the carbonyl group undergoes resonance with the pi electrons of the phenyl ring, as a result of which this carbon has a partial double bond character. And because of this partial double bond character, the positive charge on the carbonyl carbon decreases and benzaldehyde becomes less reactive than aliphatic aldehydes. If we look into aromatic ketones, then in aromatic ketones, two factors are taking place. First is the resonance effect here. Second, what we find is that this methyl group has a plus I effect. And because of this plus I effect, it further decreases the positive charge on this carbonyl group and it becomes less reactive than benzaldehyde towards nucleophilic addition reactions. So this is the order of reactivity of aldehydes and ketones. So what we have to keep in mind that when we are discussing the order of reactivity of aldehydes and ketones, we have to remember that electron donating groups will decrease the reactivity of the aldehyde or a ketone, and even if there is conjugation or plus R effect operative in the molecule, this will decrease the reactivity towards the nucleophile. Whereas if an electron withdrawing group is present, that is, it is exerting a minus I or a minus R effect, then in that case, it will be more reactive towards nucleophilic addition reactions. So we have to keep in mind two points: the electronic effects and the steric hindrance also. If by chance we are comparing ketones, isomeric ketones, then we have to keep in mind if there is more of branching in the chain, then that chain will be, that particular ketone will be less reactive because of the steric hindrance, because the nucleophile will not be able to approach the electrophilic carbon of the carbonyl group. So after this, what we have to discuss now in detail is the mechanism of the nucleophilic addition reactions and how do these reactions take place. So nucleophilic addition reactions can either be base catalyzed, that is, they can be carried out under neutral or basic conditions, or they may be acid catalyzed, that is, they can be carried out under acidic conditions. One very interesting reaction of aldehydes and ketones is addition of water to a ketone or an aldehyde. So when a water adds to an aldehyde or ketone, the rate of reaction is very slow because water is a weak nucleophile and the carbonyl carbon of the aldehyde or a ketone is also a weak electrophilic site. So this reaction can either be carried out in presence of an acid or a base. Today we shall be discussing the mechanism of acid-catalyzed reaction. But before we proceed, let us see what happens when water adds to an aldehyde or a ketone. A hydrate is formed. So what is a hydrate? A hydrate is a gemdiol in which two OH groups are attached to the same carbon. And this molecule is unstable. Hence the reaction is reversible reaction. So if I look into the mechanism of this reaction under acidic conditions, what we find is that this reaction takes place in three steps. First is the protonation. Second is the addition of the nucleophile. Then third is the deprotonation to give us the final product. So as I've said that the water is a weak nucleophile, so the reaction rate is going to be slow. So we have to do something in order so that the reaction becomes feasible. So what is done? That the reaction is carried out in acidic medium. When this happens, protonation of the carbonyl oxygen takes place, resulting in the formation of an electrophilic carbon. So this carbon, carbonyl carbon, is a good electrophile now. And the water molecule, which is acting as a nucleophile, through lone pair of electrons on oxygen, comes and adds here, resulting in a tetrahedral intermediate. In the next step, which is an acid-base reaction, water molecule again acts as a base and it abstracts a proton from this, resulting in the formation of a diol. And we know when the two OH or two electronegative groups are attached to the same carbon, the molecule is unstable and the reaction here is a reversible reaction. So whether the reaction is reversible or whether the hydrate formed is stable will depend on the nature of the groups attached to the carbonyl group. If the groups attached are alkyl groups, such as in case of acetone, then what we find is that hydrate is not stable. And only 0.2% of acetone hydrate is formed at equilibrium. Whereas in case of formaldehyde, the hydrate is stable and we get 99.9% of formaldehyde hydrate. So what happens during this course of reaction is, as I've already discussed, that our substrate or the reactant is planar in structure. So the bond angle there is 120. But when water molecule adds across the double bond, the bond angle changes to 109.5, as a result of which there are steric interactions between the alkyl groups. So if we are replacing, there are more and more alkyl groups in the substrate, then the equilibrium will be shifted towards the left. That is, it will favor the formation of the reactant. And it will stabilize the carbonyl compound and destabilize the hydrate. This is what we've shown here, that the hydrate of acetone is least stable and hydrate of formaldehyde is most stable because the bulky alkyl groups are not present here. Whereas if we look into chloral hydrate, that is the hydrate of chloral, then this molecule is very stable. And it can also be isolated. It is stable because there is intramolecular hydrogen bonding in the chloral hydrate, which stabilizes the molecule, and it can be isolated. The next important reaction of aldehydes and ketones is reaction with hydrocyanic acid when cyanohydrins are formed. What we find in this reaction is that in the course of a reaction, a new carbon-carbon bond is formed. And since a new carbon-carbon bond is formed, this is a step-up reaction. And if we look into the structure of cyanohydrin, then what we find is that cyanohydrins are those molecules in which OH and CN is attached to the same carbon atom. And these reactions are of lot of synthetic importance because the cyanohydrin formed can be made to undergo further reactions at the cyano group, which will give us some very interesting compounds. So if I look into the structure of these aldehydes and ketones, as we've already discussed, that as the branching will increase, the steric hindrance will increase, the plus I effect will increase, and that particular ketone will be less reactive towards HCN. So in this case, what we find is that aldehydes are most reactive, followed by acetaldehyde is most reactive, followed by acetone, then methyl tertiary butyl ketone. In methyl tertiary butyl ketone, one side is the steric hindrance is not there because of the presence of the methyl group. Whereas if we talk of tri tertiary butyl ketone, then there is steric hindrance from either of the sides because of the presence of tertiary butyl group. And secondly, these two groups will exert a greater plus I effect, due to which the positive charge on carbonyl group will be decreased and it will be less reactive towards nucleophilic addition reaction. So what we have to do is that when we do the reaction in presence of with HCN, reaction has to be done in a slightly basic medium. So what is done is we take an aldehyde or a ketone and NaCN in a mixture in a test tube, and then we add little amount of sulfuric acid to it when HCN is formed. And in this case, cyanide acts as a nucleophile. Reaction has to be done in a slightly acidic medium so that we have lot of free CN minus, cyanide ion. So what happens in this reaction is we can do it in two ways, that the cyanide ion acts here as a nucleophile. It goes and adds to the carbonyl carbon of the ketone, resulting in the formation of a tetrahedral intermediate, which then undergoes protonation to form the product. Or what we can say is that when we do the reaction with HCN in the presence of KCN, the protonation of oxygen takes place. This increases the electrophilicity of this carbon because here oxygen has a positive charge on it. So oxygen will pull the electrons towards itself, as a result of which this carbon will have a formal positive charge. And now this CN makes a bond with this, resulting in the formation of cyanohydrin, which is methylonitrile. Another interesting factor about this reaction is that this reaction is a reversible reaction. So if we do hydrolysis of cyanohydrin, we will get back the original aldehyde and HCN. The formation of cyanohydrins, as I said, is synthetically a very important reaction, because if we do the reduction of cyanide with lithium aluminium hydride, it results in the formation of a primary amine. So what we can do is that is we can prepare a amino alcohol by this method. So when we do the reduction with lithium aluminium hydride in THF followed by hydrolysis, what we get here is 2-amino-1-phenyl-ethanol by reduction of methylonitrile. Similarly, if we do the hydrolysis of cyanide, acidic hydrolysis, what we can get is a corresponding carboxylic acid, that is mendelic acid. So this reaction is of great synthetic importance because we can get interesting compounds having one carbon more than the starting parent. Because if we see here, benzaldehyde has one carbon in the side chain, whereas when we look into the product, then in product we have two carbons in the side chain. Now, mendelonitrile is a very important, biologically important compound. And as we've already said, that the formation of mendelonitrile is a reversible reaction. That is, if we do hydrolysis of mendelonitrile, it will give us back benzaldehyde. And this ability of the reaction has been exploited by millipede. Millipede uses this in its defense mechanism. Mendelonitrile is first released from an inner storage gland to the outer chamber of the millipede. And this undergoes acidic hydrolysis, enzymatic hydrolysis, and is converted to benzaldehyde and HCN. Now, when millipede feels the danger, this mendelonitrile is converted into benzaldehyde and HCN enzymatically in its outer chamber, and it sprays it on its enemy. That is how millipede defends itself. Another interesting feature of these reactions is of the reactions of aldehydes and ketones with HCN or other compounds is that in the process of the reaction, what we find is that a chiral center is generated here. When a chiral center is generated here, that means what we can assume is that the reaction will be accompanied by racemization. Why do we think that the reaction is accompanied by racemization? Now, if we look into the structure of the carbonyl group, what we find here is that this carbonyl group is planar in structure. Since it is planar in structure, now the nucleophile can attack from the either side, from the either plane of the molecule, hence resulting in a racemic mixture. That is, we will get a mixture of D enantiomer as well as L enantiomer. So when we do the reaction of benzaldehyde with HCN, what we are getting here is we are getting the mendelonitrile, the D isomer, as well as the L isomer. But, however, if we do the reaction in presence of enzyme, then what happens is we are able to get only one enantiomer. Why does this happen? Because enzyme blocks one face of the carbonyl compound. And since the one face of carbonyl compound is blocked, hence nucleophile can attack only from one side, resulting in the formation of one enantiomer, which may be D form or the L form. So what we can see is that we can modify the reactions of the carbonyl compounds, and we want to just get one enantiomer, then we can carry out the reactions in presence of enzymes. Now, before we proceed further, I want to clarify one thing here, that these nucleophilic addition reactions can be reversible and they can follow a path of nucleophilic addition elimination reactions. As we've already seen that during nucleophilic addition reactions, a tetrahedral compound is formed. Now, if in the course of reaction, the nucleophile that we are using in an aqueous acidic medium is an oxygen or a nitrogen atom, which has lone pair of electrons on it, then in that case, the OH group of the tetrahedral intermediate is protonated. And this group, now OH has been converted into a water molecule, into H2O, which is a good living group. And in this case, now this OH is eliminated off as water. This reaction is facilitated by the lone pair of electrons on nitrogen or the oxygen. This reaction is reversible in nature because the two electronegative groups attached to the tetrahedral intermediate are capable of being protonated, and either of them can be eliminated. So if we look into the mechanism of the reaction, then what we find here is that the product formed here is a tetrahedral product. And the nucleophile in this case is an atom which has a lone pair of electrons on it. So since it has a lone pair of electrons on it, so first what is happening here is addition reaction has taken place to give us this product, that is a tetrahedral product. Now since this OH can react with a acidic acid present in the reaction, and it undergoes protonation at this point, and OH is converted into a good leaving group, which is H2O. Now this O water is eliminated. At the same time, this lone pair of electrons form a pi bond with this carbon, facilitating in the removal of this water molecule, and we get a product. So this product is a result of nucleophilic addition elimination reaction. So the interesting example of this reaction is the addition of bisulfite. Bisulfite addition is a reaction of practical importance because liquid carbonyl compounds are difficult to purify. And supposing now if I want to separate acetone from acetic acid, how can we do that? We can add a bisulfite, sodium bisulfite, to the reaction mixture. When acetone will react with sodium bisulfite to give us a bisulfite addition compound, which is crystalline in nature, and it will precipitate out. This can be filtered and recrystallized to get pure acetone. Whereas if we look into the mechanism of the reaction, what we find here is that the bisulfite ion acts as a nucleophile and reacts with the carbonyl carbon of the aldehyde or a ketone. Now the question arises, both the atoms here, sulfur as well as oxygen, are nucleophilic in nature. Then why does sulfur act as a nucleophilic site? We know that sulfur is a stronger nucleophile as compared to oxygen, and it acts as a nucleophile from this site, resulting in the formation of a tetrahedral intermediate. And in the next step, what happens is a proton exchange takes place, resulting in the formation of crystalline addition product, which can be separated. But what we have to keep in mind is that the ketones, in which there is a bulky alkyl group, or acetophenone, does not undergo bisulfite addition reactions because of steric hindrance. Thank you. Thank you. In this session of aldehydes and ketones, we shall be discussing reactions of aldehydes and ketones with alcohols. When aldehydes and ketones react with alcohols in presence of anhydrous acids, that is gaseous HCl or concentrated sulfuric acid, they result in formation of hemiacetals and acetals. In hemiacetal, hemi is a Greek word meaning half. So when we do the reaction of an aldehyde or a ketone with one molecule of alcohol, it results in the formation of hemiacetal. That is, the reaction has proceeded till the half. And then we do the reaction with second molecule of alcohol, we get an acetyl. Hemiacetals are those compounds in which OH and OR group is attached to the same carbon. Whereas in case of a acetyl, the two OR groups are attached to the same carbon. These reactions are reversible reactions. So in case we want to proceed the reaction in the right hand direction, the water formed during the reaction should be removed, or we should take aldehyde or a ketone in excess for the reaction to proceed further. So now if we look into the formation, the mechanism of formation of hemiacetal, then what we find here is that hemiacetal reacts first with one molecule of an acid and it undergoes protonation. And when it undergoes protonation, it forms, in this case, this carbon now becomes electrophilic in nature. We have to carry out the reaction in an acidic medium so that protonation takes place and this carbon can be converted into an electrophilic site, because we know alcohol is a poor nucleophile. So when this reaction has taken place, the protonation of oxygen makes this carbonyl group more electrophilic. And then in the second step, what happens is alcohol, which is acting as a nucleophile, goes and reacts with this carbonyl carbon, resulting in the formation of a tetrahedral addition compound. This results in the formation of a tetrahedral addition compound. Now, what happens in the next step is deprotonation takes place. In deprotonation, what happens is that the water molecule, again acting as a base, removes a proton from here, resulting in the formation of hemiacetal. So what we find in case of hemiacetal is that OH and OR group are attached to the same carbon. Now this hemiacetal, on further reaction with alcohol, that is with the second molecule of alcohol, will result in the formation of acetyl. So in the first step, what happens is the protonation of hemiacetyl takes place, resulting in the formation of this intermediate, which is an oxonium ion, or we can say which is a O-acyl derivative. Now what happens is there is an equilibrium between the two. In the next step, this OH has been now converted into a good leaving group, which is H2O, and this will depart. This will also be depart because this carbon is attached to oxygen where lone pair of electrons are present. These lone pair of electrons will facilitate the removal of this as a water molecule. And what we find here is we get a resonance stabilized cation. And in this resonance stabilized cation, what we find here is that the carbon has a positive charge on it and it becomes highly electrophilic in nature. In the next step, the second molecule of alcohol comes and reacts with this, resulting in a formation of a protonated acetyl. And then this protonated acetyl again loses a proton to convert itself into an acetyl. Now we have seen that this reaction is reversible. So that means this acetyl which is formed should be unstable and we should get back the aldehyde or a ketone. But if the reaction is carried out in absence of water, then acetyl is stable, because what we find here is if this acetyl removes or eliminates this OCH3 methoxy group, then we will go back to this intermediate, and this intermediate is less stable as compared to acetyl, because here oxygen has a positive charge on it. Hence, this reversible reaction is not possible. But if we do the reaction, somehow we add water to it, then the reaction becomes reversible and we will get back the aldehyde or a ketone plus alcohol from where we started the reaction. So what we have to keep in mind is that alcohols react with aldehydes, that is one molecule of alcohol reacts with an aldehyde to give us a hemiacetyl. Hemiacetyl reacts with second molecule of alcohol to give us an acetyl. And during the course of the reaction condition should be anhydrous. And if water is present in the reaction, then reaction becomes reversible. Now, a question may be asked to you, which of the following compounds are hemiacetyl, acetyl, or neither? Now, what you have to keep in mind is, what is a hemiacetyl? A hemiacetyl is a compound in which carbon is attached to a OH group as well as a ether group, that is here a methoxy group. So our first compound is a hemiacetyl. If I look into the second compound, then what we find here is that this carbon is attached to two hydroxy groups. Since two hydroxy groups are present here, so this compound is a diol, that is, it is neither a aldehyde, neither a acetyl, nor a hemiacetyl. If we look into the third compound, then what we find here is this compound is a acetyl, because in this carbon is attached to two alkyl groups, that means it will be a ketonic compound. And then we have two ether groups, alkoxy groups here. One is isopropoxy and the other is methoxy. And this is an acetyl. So what is an acetyl? An acetyl is a compound in which two alkoxy groups are attached to the same carbon. So if we go on to the next question, now this question can be asked in another way also, that if these acetyls are made to hydrolyze, they undergo hydrolysis, acid hydrolysis, what are the carbonyl compounds that they will generate? So without going into the mechanics of the reaction, let us see here, like this compound is an aldehyde, a derivative of an aldehyde acetyl. So what we have to remember here is that this OH, if we break the bond between here, between this carbon and oxygen and then this carbon and oxygen, that is we add a water molecule here. Now this O is electronegative, so H plus will go here and OH will go to this carbon. Similarly, in this case, again, H plus will go here and OH will go to this carbon. So when this happens here, the bond will cleave, resulting in the formation of an aldehyde. Similarly, when we take another example, again, in this case, it is a ketyl. So when we talk of a ketyl, then what we find here again is we have to do a similar reaction. That is, to oxygen, we have to add H, and to a carbon, we have to add OH. When we do this, then now the carbon will come with the two OH attached to it. We have to remove this as a water molecule, which will result in the formation of a ketone and two alcohols. So let us go back. What we have to do is, we have to add H here and OH on this carbon. Again, a H here and a OH on this carbon. So this bond will cleave here and this bond will cleave here, resulting in the formation of the alcohols. Similarly, we'll get a compound in which two OH are attached to the same carbon. Now we will remove water from this molecule, resulting in the formation of a ketone. So this is how we can regenerate the carbonyl compound from a given acetyl or a given ketyl. Now in this case, we have to draw the aldehydes and ketones and alcohols that is will result when we treat them with acidic water. So what we have to remember is that is we have to please remember now you have to keep in mind is that you are going to break the bond here. This will result in alcohol, that is ethanol. Again, H will go to this oxygen, resulting in the formation of methanol. And 2OH are coming on this carbon from two water molecules. And this results in the formation of 2-butanone. So in this case, the products formed will be 2-butanol, ethanol from here, and a methanol from here. Secondly, in the next example, please remember again, what are you going to do? From a water molecule, we are going to bring H to this oxygen, OH to this carbon. This will break this into isopropyl alcohol. And then we have to bring H here and OH here. So from here, we are getting methanol and propanaldehyde. Similarly, if we look into another structure here. So again, here what we are getting is ethanol, if we add H here again, we will get methanol. And then when we are getting here, from here we will get a ketone here. The ketone will be methyl isobutyl ketone. So this is very easy to bring about the hydrolysis and predict the products. What we have to simply do is we have to break the bond between carbon and oxygen. The oxygen moiety will be converted into alcohol. Again, here the oxygen moiety will be converted into alcohol and the carbon moiety will be converted into an aldehyde or a ketone. Now, supposing another very important aspect of acetyl formation is, as we've discussed again and again, that the formation of acetyl is a reversible reaction. That is, in anhydrous conditions, acetyls are formed. And if we bring about acidic hydrolysis of acetyls, the carbonyl compounds are regenerated. Now, supposing in a molecule, we have two functional groups. That is the carbonyl group, CO group, and an acidic group. And we want to convert this keto acid into a keto alcohol. That means we want to reduce the carboxylic group, but we do not want to reduce the keto group. What shall we do? In such a case, what we do is, we react the molecule with a reagent, which will react with only one of the groups of the substrate and convert it into an inert moiety, which will not be able to react with the reacting reagent, that is with lithium aluminium hydride in this case. And after the desired reaction has been carried out, we will do the hydrolysis of the reaction to get back the product. So such reagents are known as protecting groups. So what we say are protecting groups are functional groups which are introduced into a molecule to convert them into another functional group in a reversible reaction. And this protecting group should be inert to basic hydrolysis or to reductions and oxidation reactions. So now supposing if I want to carry out this reaction, so what I find here is that if I convert this into acetyl, we can carry out the further reactions. They are supposing some other functional groups present here. We will bring about those reactions. And after those reactions have been carried out, what we will do is we will do the hydrolysis of this product, which will then bring about the desired reaction where we want to bring it and regenerate the carbonyl compound without affecting the carbonyl compound. So this reaction, what we find is, first we prepare acetyl, then we do the further reactions, then we do the hydrolysis when the desired product is regenerated. So if I think of this reaction, so what we find here is, we have here converted this cyclohexanol into a ketone. Please remember, ketones react with dihydric alcohols. So what we find here is this gives us a large number of opportunities to play with the molecules, because we can change the substrates as well as we can change the alcohols. We can make it a diol or we can take a monohydric alcohol. Normally, ketones react with diols. That is, in this case, cyclohexanone reacts with a 1,2 ethane 1,2 diol, resulting in a formation of a ketyl. And in this way, we are protecting this carbonyl group. So now I have a moiety here in which we have a carbonyl group here and a acetic group here. What do we want to do here is we want to convert this carboxylic group into an alcoholic group. That is, I want to reduce this carboxylic group to a primary alcoholic group. How can we do this? Now, I know that if we are using lithium aluminium hydride or any other reducing agent other than sodium borohydride, then what we find is that these two groups will be reduced to alcoholic group. That is, from this carboxylic group, I'll get a primary alcoholic group, whereas from this keto group, we will get a secondary alcoholic group. So this reaction is very difficult to carry out. It seems to be difficult, but this can be carried out. How can we do this? We will first carry out the protection. That is, we will treat this molecule with ethylene glycol. When we do the reaction with ethylene glycol, this ethylene glycol will react with this carbonyl group, with the ketonic group, converting it into a ketyl. Now we will do the reaction with lithium aluminium hydride. This group is now insensitive or is inert to reduction with lithium aluminium hydride, and the carboxylic group will undergo reduction with lithium aluminium hydride to give us an alcoholic group here. That is, it will be reduced preferentially. Now what we do here is, now we've got the desired product. That is, desired product was to reduce this carboxylic group. Otherwise, if we had reduced lithium aluminium hydride as a reducing agent and not done the protection, it would have reduced this carbonyl group here. So now we've done the protection, done the reaction with lithium aluminium hydride, when we've got an alcoholic group here. Now, in the last step, what we do is we do acid hydrolysis. When we do acid hydrolysis, this group, the ketyl group, will be converted to the carbonyl group and we will get the desired synthesis. So what we find is that the formation of acetyls and ketyls are very important, because we can then prepare the desired compounds without affecting these groups. Secondly, thing is that we have to keep in mind that if we have a ketonic group in the molecules as well as aldehydic group in the molecule, then please remember that the aldehydic group will preferentially form a acetyl. So what happens here is, now we want to reduce this group to a secondary alcoholic group. Now I know that if we do the reaction with lithium aluminium hydride or with sodium borohydride, both these groups will be reduced to alcoholic groups. So in order to prevent this reaction, what we do is, first we do the formation of acetyl by doing the reaction with ethylene glycol in acetic medium. When we do this, then this CHO group is involved in acetyl formation, and this COCH3 group is left unaffected. Now we bring about the reduction with sodium borohydride. When this group is reduced to a CHOH group, and this molecule, this group is retained here as such. Now in the last step, to get the desired product, we do the acidic hydrolysis. And when acidic hydrolysis is carried out, this acetyl breaks down to give us the aldehyde, and we get the desired product. So this was the basic reason why in between I discussed so many questions to find out which product, what will we get if we do hydrolysis of a given acetyl or a ketyl. So now it's very plain, or it is very simple, that when we do the hydrolysis of this compound, the CHO group will be regenerated and we will get the desired product. So now we know that the acetyls and ketyls are unstable, and they can, on doing acidic hydrolysis, we can get back the original aldehyde or a ketone. Another very important or a very interesting example of hemiacetals and hemiketals are formed in those compounds which are polyhydroxy aldehydes or ketones. In a polyhydroxy aldehyde or a ketone, we have more than two hydroxyl groups in the same molecule along with an aldehydic or a carbonyl group. And then when we do the reaction between an aldehydic and an alcoholic group, the molecule results in the formation of a cyclic hemiacetal. And this cyclic hemiacetal is stable because here it is attached, the enomeric, the carbon here is attached to an alkyl group and a OH group, and they can be isolated. Next, what we know is that if we go back to a stereochemistry, that five-membered rings and six-membered rings are most stable. Especially the six-membered rings are most stable because according to Beer strain theory, they have a puckered structure and the bond angle is 109. So they are very stable structures. So what we find is that if we have a glucose molecule, it has a tendency to react with the OH group, which is the aldehyde group has a tendency to react with the OH group, which is present on the fifth carbon, resulting in the formation of a hemiacetal. So what we've seen here is that this glucose molecule, here the aldehyde group reacts with this OH on the fifth carbon to form a ring structure. And this oxygen will become the ring enomeric, the oxygen of the ring. So let us now look into the formation of this. So when this reaction takes place, which I'll be now discussing very shortly, we generate a new chiral center. And at this chiral center, the configuration of the two hydroxyl groups is different. And these two isomers are called enomers, because if we look into the structure of these here, what I mean by why are these two structures called enomers, because they differ in configuration of the OH only at this chiral carbon here or this chiral carbon here. And this carbon is an enomeric carbon because in this enomeric carbon it is attached to two oxygens. So a question may be asked that they may give you a structure and then they may ask you which is an enomeric carbon. So if you look at this structure carefully, what we find is in this structure, there's only one carbon, this carbon, which is attached to two oxygens here. And the second thing that has to be taken into consideration is when we are discussing these two molecules is that the configuration is different only at the enomeric carbon. At rest of the carbons, if we see here, 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 and if I compare it with this molecule here, the structure is the same, the configuration is the same. Therefore, these are not optical isomers. Now, if we go on to the next structure here, now the question arises, how does this cyclization or this reaction takes place? So if I write down the open chain structure of an aldehyde, of a polyhydroxy aldehyde, that is glucose, then CHO molecule, CHO group is written at the top and CH2OH is written at the bottom. Now we will write this molecule in such a way that the CH2OH goes behind the ring and it comes in front of the carbonyl group here. Now if I twist the molecule here and in this direction if we move the groups, then what we find is that this OH is placed directly in front of this carbonyl group here, the aldehyde group here. This carbon, this oxygen here, forms a bond with this carbon, and this H goes to this oxygen here, resulting in the formation of a hemiacetal. And this results, now since this is making a bond here, till here we had a double bond between carbon and oxygen. Here the rotation was restricted. Whereas if we look here, we have a single bond here, and now the rotation is free. And what we find here is that this results in two configurations. One is in which the OH is on the opposite side to this CH2OH group on the fifth carbon, which is the alpha D glucose, and the other one is the beta D glucose, in which the enomeric OH is on the same side as the CH2OH. So what we find is that hemiacetals play a very important role in carbohydrate chemistry also. We shall be discussing this in details when we do the carbohydrates. In my next lecture, we will proceed further with the reaction of aldehydes and ketones with ammonia and ammonia derivatives. Thank you.
Dear friends, we hope that with today's lecture you were able to understand newer aspects of aldehydes and ketones, and we hope to bring more lectures on the same topic. On that note, we would like to thank Dr. Chauhan for coming here.
Thank you so much.
And delivering this wonderful lecture. And thank you, dear friends, for watching our lecture. Stay tuned and keep watching. Thank you.